as I said, my name's Alan Rothschild, and I sit on the board of a foundation in Columbus where I practice law. And the founder of the foundation said, I want to do something to encourage y'all's participation in the foundation and to try to make the foundation even more entrepreneurial in what we do. So I'm going to let each trustee allocate a very small amount of the total. And worst case scenario, if everybody votes down your favorite idea, you can give a little money to that from your individually designated fund. But hopefully, what you can do is fund some ideas that maybe are outside of the current thinking of the foundation board. And if that turns into something, maybe the foundation will support it. So I'm a big believer in the value of the arts and was giving a little bit of money to the Georgia Museum, to the Columbus Museum, to the High, to the LaGrange Museum. And I just realized that sprinkling a little fairy dust to each of the museums, I'm sure it was well used, but it really wasn't making an obvious difference in their program. So I decided to roll all that money in the small individual allocation I could do and seed something to try to see if all that money together could make a difference. And after thinking about a number of different ways to approach it, I realized that photography is still a very reasonable medium. You can buy good photography relatively cheap still. Personally, photography was always meaningful to me. It's really hard to see this, but when I was a history major in college, you would read in the survey textbooks about the Civil War and that there were 50,000 casualties at Gettysburg. And that meant nothing to me until I turned the page and saw one of Matthew Brady's famous images, and we're all familiar with those, but the dead-blooded soldiers on the battlefield in the ragtag clothes, the guns and the shoes are gone because somebody needed them. And I learned a lot more about the Civil War in looking at Brady's images than I did in all kind of text. And I remembered the same thing happened when we studied the Great Depression, and y'all are all familiar with Walker Evans' images from the 1930s in the Black Belt of Alabama. And again, 25% unemployment didn't mean anything to me. But when I saw Bud Field's family and how poor they were, and if you had any sense, so these are the white folks in Alabama in the 1930s, imagine what the non-white folks must have looked like. But I realized that either I was a visual learner or the power of these photographs to convey a message were very important to me. And you know, it just continued as we turned the pages and got further into it. This is actually an image in the collection. One of Charles Moore's famous civil rights photographs of the fire hose at the Birmingham riots in the early 60s. And you know, these images were so powerful that almost all of the civil rights leaders acknowledged that we would not have had a successful civil rights movement had there not been cameras present. But an image like that told me, anyway, a whole lot more about the history of the South and pages of books about civil rights. I didn't think about this, but one of the questions we had to answer early on, if we're going to build a collection of photographs taken in the South, and that's one of our requirements, and since World War II is another, we had to figure out how you define the South. And is that the Confederate States? Is that south of the Mason-Dixon line? You can't see the slide, but this gray area is out of a history textbook, and it's the region in which country grows. And it sounds as good as any to me, but you see it, you may be able to see it covers eastern Texas, which we do, because I think eastern Texas looks a lot like Louisiana, and I don't think most of us debate that Louisiana's the South, but you get right across the border in eastern Texas where we don't have cowboy hats and cowboy boots and we don't have cactus look a lot like us. And the same thing when you get into the coal mining country up in West Virginia, that looks a lot like some of the mill villages of the South when you see the people in the places. And so we don't have a rigid definition of the South, but it's a lot like the kudzu map. because I feel that, you know, geographically, Florida is certainly part of the South, but the further south you get Florida, the less it feels like part of us. The goal is to collect museum-quality photography that was taken in the South since World War II, and to make this photography available in places that maybe the audiences don't have the opportunity to see museum-quality photography on a regular basis. Y'all are familiar that we are just finishing up a six-venue show here in Athens, and y'all have an opportunity to see a lot of great stuff, but with the community programming that Dee Dee and her team does here, we think we're able to get people in to see these photographs that might not have an opportunity to see them at the High or a New York museum or wherever. But we're particularly proud of some of the more rural venues. This isn't necessarily rural. This was our premier show. There was an abandoned storefront in Columbus, and we got some Columbus State students to take on as a project doing a soup to nuts photography show. They picked the image, they came up with the theme, they came up with the title, they did all the marketing, they invited three photographers to come to town, and they required, at my request, each of those photographers to do something with the community when they were in town. So one of the photographers took a high school class out and shot in the community and then critiqued their work. Two of the other photographers taught at Columbus State in a photography class. And it's that type of unusual location and interaction with the work and the community that's really important with what we're doing. I started as a joke, but it's actually kind of growing into the truth, and we may write it into our loan agreements. The only rule I have about exhibitions is no black turtlenecks and no cheap white wine, because there's enough of that that's being done. This is a picture from a storefront in Marion, Alabama, in Perry County, and those of you who are familiar with Kristen Berry and Walker Evans' work, Perry County is where the Sprott Church and the Sprott Corner Store is. One of Evans' famous images is all these men on the front porch of this old store right outside of Marion. And I was talking to Bill Island at the museum one time, and some of y'all may know this, but Bill's actually from Marion County. And it's his great uncle that's one of the people in this portrait, in this photograph that Walker Evans took. But we were really proud of the show. Part of it was in Perry County. And the other part of it was in Hale County, which anybody, and you all know, is really sort of ground zero of traditional Southern photography. That's where Evans took his famous images. The Bud Fields family image before, from the 1930s, was taken in Hale County. And of course, that's where we and Kristen Berry came from the 1960s until just recently, when he got too sick to travel to photograph every summer. Two things that sort of illustrate what we're trying to achieve. In this show, we had two Kristen Berry images up. And one of the visitors said, "I know Bill. I see him every year. But I've never seen his photographs." And it is odd to me that he spent his whole career down taking pictures. There are lots of his work in the Montgomery Museum. There are a lot of his images in the Birmingham Museum. But for a lot of these folks, Birmingham's about as close as New York is. And it was really great to have these images on the main street of Greensboro. And those of you familiar with Evans' work, he did some beautiful streetscape scenes from a second or third story building in Greensboro, looking down the main drag. And you could hold those pictures up today and still recognize about 90 of the buildings. And our exhibition was next door to where he took those pictures. I don't know if anybody got either to the Russell Library to see the Gordon Park segregation images while they were up, or saw them when they were at the High last summer. But we also had the Gordon Park segregation series up at this show in Greensboro, Alabama last summer. And I realized that some of those images were taken in Choctaw County, which was 80 miles away. And I will guarantee you that those images had never been and likely never will be any closer to where they were taken than when this group, and the group that hosted us in Greensboro, was a low-income housing advocate. But they know the value of art, even to the poorest of the poor, and they put on a big community celebration with this work of art. And not only did we show people what Kristen Berry had been photographing all these years, and there were a couple of people walking down looking at these images of, hey, that's my barn, and hey, that's my aunt's house, and stuff like that. But there's a photographer from New Orleans, and Keith Carter, and he and his wife, Chandra, and they go by Chandra and Keith is their stage name. And they had a wonderful show at the Ogden a couple of years ago of the inside of Angola Prison. And the message from their show, these were two African-American photographers, and the message of their show is about how many African-Americans are in jail in Louisiana, which is kind of the worst in our country, which has one of the highest rates of incarceration. And it was just one beautiful image. And it turned out that that series was selected to be one of the few American representatives at the Venice Biennale, summer of, I guess, 15. And so we had that image. And I believe the only two places on earth that summer you could see that those photographs was in Venice or in Perry County, Alabama. And so that was pretty cool to me. This is one that's kind of hard to see, but there's a photographer who does a lot of work in Appalachia. He's had a couple of shows in Atlanta. His name's Bill Relieve. And this is a concrete sign. It's a beautiful coal train in the back, but it's a concrete sign that says, prepare to meet God. And this illustrates something that I'm not a photographer. I mean, I do it as an amateur, but I come about this because of my interest and love of history and people and place. And I hope these are good photographs, and I hope that a museum one day will want to have this collection. And I hope y'all don't get up and leave because this is a photography deal, but to me, it's the stories that the photographs tell that make this fun. And when I learned a little bit about what the story of that sign, I just knew we needed to have this image. There was a coal miner or coal mine worker named Harrison Mays in the 1930s working in Kentucky. And he got injured in a coal mining accident, severely injured and was near death. And he prayed to God and said, if you will get me well, I will spend the rest of my days on earth going out preaching the gospel. And it turned out that's exactly what he did. Impossible to see, but this is a map of the United States, and all of those black lines are trips that Reverend Harrison Mays, as he became later in life, made 20 years in the 1960s, 20 years after his injury, driving around the United States, mostly in the Southeast, putting up signs like the one in that image. And as happenstance is, and I don't know what you call the term, but once you know something, you all of a sudden see it everywhere, and before you knew it, you were oblivious to it. 2 years ago, I was oblivious to this, but after learning about it through that photograph, I was driving over to our show in Greensboro, Alabama, absolutely in the middle of nowhere without cell phone service, and something caught my eye. I was with my sister, and we were actually driving over in a van to pick up these images. And I said, wait a minute. So I turn around and come back, and on the side of the road is a concrete cross that's a Reverend Harrison Mays cross. And my sister is a lot better person than me, because I'm sitting with an empty cargo van and a sign on the side of the road. I'm going, I think it will fit. She goes, there's no way you're stealing the cross of my life. And so I got back to the office, and being a lawyer, these kind of questions intrigued me. But he was a crafty guy. Reverend Mays would put these signs up right on the edge of the public right-of-way, so nobody really knew whether they were on public property or private property. And this one, you can see that there's a fence line right here. I mean, just right under the right arm of the cross is the fence line, so it's on public property. And I'm sitting there thinking, well, you're not supposed to put stuff up on public property, and we're kind of a museum. I think legally we have an issue. I'm worried a little bit about the religious aspects of it, but maybe if I get a priest over there to oversee this thing. So I got my secretary to do a little look in, and she came in and she goes, I got bad news. And I said, what's that? She goes, apparently Reverend Mays, when he put these things in the ground, taped a little note to the back of them that said, if you steal this cross, you will burn in hell. I don't know what the legal answer is, but that one is still in Alabama. This is one that I just wish y'all could see this, but this is a picture of a lady outside a curb market that's obviously New Orleans. It's an elderly woman, sort of with a gloomy face, looking at the camera. It's taken by a guy named Kevin Klein, and I don't know, he doesn't promote himself very well, but people in the know say that he is far and away the best street photographer in New Orleans today. Just takes beautiful work, traditional printing processes. And again, I come from the history side and storytelling and the folklore side of things and not from the high art side of things. But I know that there's a great debate about how much information that you should put on your work of art. I mean, some people don't even think you should sign your paintings because that taints the viewer's interpretation of things and whether you should put wall tags up and things like that. I mean, my personal view is you ought to not be a lazy viewer and give it your best shot, but if there's something to tell, then don't let me leave the gallery without knowing it. And this is the perfect example of it, because this picture of this lady on the curb, the name of the picture is Man on the Curb. So, you know, okay, well, this is just a typical New Orleans crazy, right? Cross-dressing. Well, the real story is that the photographer and this guy were neighbors, and he had just lost his wife of 40 years, and during a period of 6 months of mourning, he wore his wife's clothes every day. Wow. And so all of a sudden, when you hear that story, to me, this just becomes an incredibly rich photograph. And my favorite part about what we're doing is not going into a gallery or not going to an auction to buy something. It's sitting down with somebody like Kevin Klein. And it actually, in this particular case, he could have taken this picture out of his front door. This is literally across the street from his house. But to have him tell you that story, or to see this Harrison Mays cross and to learn about Harrison Mays and be driving down a road in rural Alabama and see one of those, that's really meaningful to me. Did any of y'all get to know Carolyn Drake when she was in Athens? This is disheartening to me because almost nobody that I know over Dodd or people around town that I talk to about photography. Carolyn Drake is the newest member of MAGNA, which may be the most prestigious group of photographers in the world. And she lived in Athens for a year, almost in obscurity. She is a Guggenheim fellow and doesn't like to grow roots. I don't think she had anything against Athens, but she had been outside of Oxford, Mississippi, heard Athens was cool, moved here, and then they took off in January and moved to California. But this is an image of an elderly black woman on a bus, and it's part of a series she did called The Maid's Bus. And Birmingham still has a bus that runs from the African-American section of town every morning out to Mountain Brook to drop the maids off. And at 5 o'clock or whatever in the afternoon, it picks the maids up and brings them back. And it's a beautiful image, but, you know, when you hear the story behind this, and, you know, is that a civil rights image? We know that the image that Charles Moore did is a civil rights image. Is that a civil rights image? I don't know. This is the Gordon Parks image that was over at Russell Ivory's sign. If you can't see it, it says colored entrance. In 1956, he came south and did this photo spread for Life magazine on the Thornton family. And if y'all want to see it, you don't need to hear this, but if you did, it's a great story. And after when this photo series was published in September of 1956, one of the Thornton adult children was quoted as saying, "Things won't get better till we end segregation." And they ran the family out of the town near Greensboro, Alabama. And when Gordon Parks found out about it, he got Life magazine to send them $25,000 to help them with the cost of relocating to Mobile. This is a beautiful image. You know, it's something about these great old vintage images. When you take one and sit it away for 30 years and pull it back out, there's just something about the fact that time's long gone that that creates just a special aura with these photographs, which is not fair for those of you who are photographing now, trying to get your work shown. But, you know, this one's not obviously a civil rights image. Charles Moore's was. This one certainly was. Y'all know Paul Kowalski, who was from Bainbridge, who was another good kind of fellow. Kowalski was a self-taught photographer and got really good at it. And back in the day when you could actually write an Ansel Adams and he'd write you back if you were serious about photography. And that's exactly what he did. He developed a relationship with three or four really, really fine and famous photographers who sort of took him under wing. But Kowalski's family owned a hardware store in Bainbridge, and he was bored with the hardware business but loved photography, and what started first is every day at lunch and then every afternoon leaving a little early, and finally he just quit the hardware business and spent his whole life taking photographs, but only in Bainbridge. He took thousands and thousands of photographs in Bainbridge. And this is an image of the senior prom in Bainbridge around 1980, but this was back when Bainbridge had separate, segregated proms. And this was his way of sort of expressing his view about it. He was not, Gordon Parks called his camera his weapon against segregation. I think Kowalski was a little more practical. He knew that in Bainbridge, perhaps he had to be a little softer in his views. But I was talking one time, said I believe this is probably Kowalski's version of a civil rights image, social justice sort of image. And somebody came up to me afterwards and said, well, let me tell you a story. A couple of years after that, they integrated the prom, but they said there would still be no interracial dancing. And Kowalski's youngest daughter was off at Emory at Oxford, and she came home for the weekend and, knowing the rule, promptly asked the African-American band member to dance with her. So they both got kicked out of the band. Her mother was deeply embarrassed and said she was, you know, it tarnished the family reputation in Bainbridge. And on Tuesday morning, there was a knock on her dorm door back at Oxford, and it was her dad there to tell her how proud he was of her. But he couldn't tell her that in Bainbridge he had to drive up to Oxford. The other part of this is not only sort of teaching us history or teaching me history, I realize that history is not all that far away. This is, again, Walker Evans' 1935-36 image from Hale County. This is really hard to see, but this is an African-American woman in a shack with the window boarded up, dressed in pretty poor clothes and screen door and all that. Well, this was taken by Baldwin Lee, and I don't know if some of y'all heard Baldwin here lecture a month ago, but this is from Baldwin series that he took when he came south from Yale and was teaching at Tennessee. He just couldn't believe the poverty in the South and drove around and documented some of it. So Walker Evans documented poverty in the South in the 1930s. Baldwin Lee drove around 50 years later, and it really wasn't a whole lot. Orion Catledge, the photographer of Cabbage Town, I don't know if y'all are familiar with his work. Catledge was an insurance guy who was also a self-taught photographer, moved to Atlanta and came across Cabbage Town, which at that time was still a very insular mill village at the Fulton Bag or whatever it is, right over there next to Oakland Cemetery in Atlanta. This doesn't exist anymore. But when you see this image, it looks just like something that Walker Evans could have photographed. This was taken in 1980. The mill shut down like 1978, 1979, and that's when the community started to dissolve because people had to move elsewhere for jobs. But descendants of these families had moved. They had been recruited from the lower Appalachians to come to Atlanta in the 1890s and 1900s. To go work for the mill, and for decades, descendants stayed in this little sort of 1 mile square area to work for the mill, and they're very unusual looking people that with from someplace over in Europe, and because they intermarried and sort of kept the look, just unusual facial features and body features. But what's interesting to me is this just looks like it could be a Walker Evans 1930s picture, except they've got bell-bottom pants on and the old Pepsi bottle with the styrofoam wrapper around the bottle. So it's just like somebody's taking this picture and put things in there that shouldn't be there. I love that picture because Columbus is a mill town, and the mill villages in Columbus have the houses that look just like this. And as does any other, whether it's Macon or Greenville or Spartanburg, we all have the housing stock that reflects those old mill villages. Just going to talk real quick about just a few images. I mean, we've got about 220 images in the collection now. Just some of them that I really like, and maybe a little bit why. Cynthia Henry has one or two images up in the shows, and if any of y'all subscribe to the Georgia Review, the image of the girl in the back of the blue station wagon was chosen by the Georgia Review to be on its cover in the current issue. And she's a Richmond photographer, and it's really just getting going in her career. And while we own some William Christianberry images and Mike Smith images and Mark Steinmetz images, we try very hard to mix in work by emerging photographers as well. And her work really struck me as beautiful color work, and she takes these pictures of these young girls sort of right when they're starting to show some characteristics of being a reaching woman. And so it's almost like some of those old paintings where they had the bodies kind of out of shape and the head was too big for the body. But you've got these children, but they show signs of being women. And she also tends to photograph them in an environment that seems to have seen its better day. That blue station wagon the girl was in was kind of an old, ratty, dirty car. And this young lady, these beautiful images, is in a house that looks like it could use a little love and care. But Cynthia has had incredible success recently. She had her first solo show at Sweetburn College in Virginia this year. She was on the cover of Georgia Review. And Mike Smith emailed me over the weekend that Mavis in the back seat image had been entered by Cynthia in the National Portrait Gallery's annual portrait competition. It's a multimedia competition, so it's painting and photography, drawing, and she won second place out of 2,500 entries. So she's had quite a nice run. Again, I'm sorry y'all can't see this image, but this is a photographer named Dennis Darling who got his undergraduate photography degree at Georgia State back in the 70s, and there's this young boy giving a look that all of us young boys do to pretty girls. And she's smiling because she appreciates the attention. But over his right shoulder, it says KKK. And this is a KKK meeting that this family, this group of people are going to. And you have this sort of sinister looking older lady in the back of the picture. And Dennis did a wonderful series of the KKK in the 70s. But what I thought was most interesting about it was, he said he got lots of mail, and half of it said, you're making these evil people look nice. And the other half said, we're really pretty nice people and you're making us look evil. So he probably got it just about right. He wasn't really trying to take sides. He was trying to be sort of neutral when he took these pictures, or so he claims. Deborah Luster, who grew up in Arkansas, but I think now divides her time between the New Orleans area and I think Ireland, because she married somebody from Ireland. This is a wonderful picture, and I'm sorry you can't see it better, but the name of it is Taxidermist's Son, and this little kid's mother is a taxidermist, and also holds like the New York, North Carolina record for largest bear with some kind of weapon, but he's holding this head of, I guess, a coyote in his hand, and he, with his hair and his face, looks like he's part animal too. And it's just wonderful, you know, this is not one of these pictures where everything balances. And I can't describe pictures very well. I just buy what I like, and I just love this one because it just all works. Pam Pecchio, I don't know if any of y'all knew Pam when she was here getting her MFA in Georgia, But she documented Athens around, I think, about 1990, when the rock, the tattoo, the more urban feel to parts of downtown was sort of getting going. And this is a beautiful image of this guy with tattoos all down his arm, driving this vintage car with just bright red lines. And the combination of that is just wonderful. She had this image buried in a box somewhere, and another photographer told me, you know Pampecchio's work. And she's got another series that she's been doing that's up in the New York galleries, and it's nice. He goes, you've got to find her Athens stuff. Make her send you her Athens stuff. And so I wrote her and bugged her and waited and waited and waited. And she finally found this in the PDF file and sent it to me. And I said, now go find the negative and print one for us. And that's what's very interesting to me about what the, you guys do is you'll work on a series and put it away and turn to something else. And once these photographers turn to another series, lots of times that's what they become interested in promoting. And we have to sort of say, well, is there anything else? Is there anything else? Let's dig down in the drawer and see what else is there. And we were very glad we did there. Y'all live in a wonderfully rich photography community. We've got a great photography department at the Dodd School. You've got, last year you had four Guggenheim Fellow photographers living in Athens, Carolyn Drake, Stephen Shear, Carl Martin, and Mark Steinmetz. And I was just over at Mark's house, and I don't know how well you all know Mark or know Mark's work, but I think Mark is more famous in Europe than he is in Athens. It's just incredible to me. I mean, he's working on a show, I forget whether it was in France or Germany, but he was just showing me a bunch of pictures he printed, and he still personally hand prints every single image, except for the very, very big ones that his equipment can't handle, but he prints them all. A lot of you, I'm sure, know Carl Martin, who's a wonderful photographer and a great patron of the arts in town. Carl curates the little gallery space at Cine, and he picked the 12 or 14 images from the Dugan Fund that were up on that right-hand wall as you walk into the theater. And like Mark Steinmetz, Carl loves to walk around town and photograph, and this is from a series that he did back in the 70s and 80s, and just some really beautiful color work. And he told me about where this picture was of the man standing on the manhole. So I was in Athens for that photographer's weekend back in February. I was out for a jog down Prince, and all of a sudden I froze because that was the spot. So I pulled out my cell phone, and here's a camera of the same manhole cover right next to the Army Navy store on Prince Avenue. And that's what photography reminds me, again, as someone interested in history and people and place, is these are not artificial images of something that exists in outer space or something that somebody made up. These are photographs of real places and real people. I get that with Walker Evans' work and Kristen Berry's work because you can go see a lot of those places. But it's fun when you, do any of you all read the Oxford American magazine? It's got some pretty nice stuff on photography. We got an image from a photographer who was in Atlanta named Walker Pickering, who now teaches at the University of Nebraska. And it was this old liquor store that had this real colorful roof stuff on it. So he took this picture of it one Sunday. And it's just this solemn-looking building. And I opened up the Oxford American that had the Georgia Music issue that's out right now, and they had a rapper standing in front of the same liquor store. It had quite a different look. Roger Manley, who's now the director of the Gregg Museum at NC State, this is one of my favorite images in the collection, but it's Reverend Ruth down at the Bible Garden that used to be in Woodville, Georgia, about 20 miles from here. It was just east of the Oconee National Forest, just right down the road, north of 20. But this guy, Roger Manley, goes around the South and documents sort of peculiar people and places. And this is just a gorgeous image. It's Reverend Ruth at Big Number 5, and it's one of my favorite ones in the collection. We've got images, as I said before, from emerging photographers and for some better-known photographers. Any of you all that know much about fine art photography in North Carolina, John Menapace, who was a self-taught photographer, later taught at Duke, but was most famous for teaching in the summers at Penland, right outside of Asheville. And he did a bunch of work in Pinland, and we've got a nice selection of Menapace's work. But he is known as the father of fine art photography in North Carolina. And a lot of people now in their 40s, 50s, 60s credit their Menapace as being the mentor in their work. Mike Smith, who was here in February, very well-known photographer. Mike spends most of his time driving around East Tennessee where he lives or Western North Carolina, just photographing things that we drive by every day. And he has this incredible ability to see something worth taking a photograph of. I mean, he's got a series of dozens and dozens of winter grasses like this, and they're some of the most beautiful photographs I've ever seen. I will throw my one little technical thing in here so you guys don't feel like I totally let you out. But all of Mike's work, sea prints. And when I went to visit him, he had a room about half this size, stacked up. He must have had 1,000 sea prints out. And he goes, come over here, Alan, and look at this. And he holds up two images that look identical to me. He goes, I finally now have a digital print that I feel like looks, you know, represents what I have done for years with my sea prints. And so, knowing a little bit about sea prints and how delicate they are, and knowing that the Do Good Fund collection travels and isn't always in museum-like condition, I said, well, Mike, wouldn't we be smarter getting digital prints if you thought you could make them look? He says, no doubt in my mind, but I'm talking against myself, and I don't know who I'm going to sell these other 1,000 sea prints to. But if you'll be patient with me, and if you'll, and for a couple of them that he hadn't scanned, if you'll cover the $70 scanning fee, we'll try this in digital. So I think the Do Good Fund has some of Mike Smith's very first digital prints. And once I'm out among the glass, I can't tell the difference. But it was when I first visited him, it was all old-fashioned way. 2 years later, every bit of that equipment was gone. He'd gone all digital. I know a lot of photographers have done that. Anna Gay was, I think, just recently got or is in the process of finishing her MFA. I was walking through the dot school one day and the MFA show was up. I said, hey, I like that picture. So it's in the collection. And it's got a lot of traction. It's a beautiful image. The story behind this one is we actually looked at two different versions of it. The first one I saw was an image of a kitchen that had a girl in it. And Anna wanted to make the skin color more realistic, so she played with it. And I thought it then became a picture about a girl in a kitchen. And we debated back and forth. And I said, you're the photographer, and you get to decide, but you put the one up on the wall that was a picture of the kitchen, and that's the one I wanted. So, and it was fluorescent light, so the skin color was burned out, but it was a beautiful image. And it's so much fun. We typically, when a host said we'd like to borrow your images and do a show, we say take it and go do it. They pick the images and they curate. So it's great to go in there and you'll have William Christenberry, and right next to it will be one of Anna Gaines. And that's not what the New York Gallery's do. They don't put the masters and the rookies together. I think it's wonderful. I think that's what it's all about. So we love to see that. Georgia Rhodes, another young, recent MFA graduate from University of Georgia. We just added her work to the collection. This is a beautiful black and white images with lots of different geometric shapes in it. My favorite way to acquire photographs, but I don't get very far. I get to see the Athens photographers, but I don't get out to lots of other places. And 2 years ago, we were trying to see what direction to go, how to add photographs to the collection so we could have a critical mass to go out and exhibit. And so we started asking lots of people. Richard McKay, the curator of photography at the Ogden. Mike Smith, who was already in the collection. Jeff Rich, who writes the Photography Column of Oxford America, at that time was teaching at SCAD. Those folks were already in the collection. And I said, part of your obligation now is to help us find other photographers. And so I kept hearing the name of a guy named Brandon Tebow. And he just does beautiful work. And this is a picture of a kid doing a backflip on a mattress that is his trampoline right next to a mobile home. And this could be a Walker Evans, this could be a Baldwin Lee, but somehow Brandon takes images of the same things, and there's a lot more hope in the images that he takes. His pictures are a lot more optimistic to me. Brandon does most of his work he prints it in digital black and whites. And we've seen lots of great digital work, and for most of us, that's just practically speaking all that we can do. But when we find a photographer that's willing to do black and white work, and silver gelatin work still, we just love to get that because it's still so beautiful. And Brandon was trying to raise some money to do a book, and he said, "Look, Alan, what I'll do is that I'm doing, you know, these single prints of these as part of the silver gelatin course I'm going to, so in grad school, and we'll sell them set to you for X." So most of the work of his that's out there, he's had some fair commercial success and exhibition success, but most of that's digital work, and we were really fortunate that he was able to work with us and do digital work. I realized early on that when you start buying pictures about the South, a lot of them end up being rural and poor, and that's not what the South is. That's part of the South, but the South's a lot more than that. And just like Pam Pecchio's tattooed arm, we want her a different South show. There's a great young photographer who really made a splash in New Orleans named Sophie Leboff, and that she did a couple of images of inside some of the wacky bars in New Orleans. Art seemed to be one of the things that really led New Orleans out of all of the horrors of Katrina, and in particularly photography. And I don't know how many of y'all have been to New Orleans in the last 5 or 7 years, but that has got to be one of the most photography-friendly places in the United States today. I mean, galleries everywhere showing photography, the museums show a lot of photography. Lots of photographers are now clustering down there doing work. And Sophie was down there for a pretty long period of time, and now teaches at Pratt Institute because her professor from Tulane moved up there and hired her, but she still gets back all the time. If y'all haven't been in New Orleans in a while, I would definitely go. So the one photographer's name that came up again and again and again was a young lady from Richmond named Susan Worsham. This is a beautiful image of a boy in a church. Looks like he's helping clean the church maybe on the Saturday before services the next day. But what's interesting to me is most of the photographers in our collection are not making a living as a full-time fine art photographer. That probably didn't come as a surprise. But the majority of them either teach or they are commercial photographers, Monday through Friday, and then they shoot their work they're passionate about on the weekends. Susan is a great exception to that. She is a waitress and is absolutely perfectly happy being a waitress. But whatever she's doing it right. All right, the last slide, I'm sorry y'all can't see this, but in this slide, we've got a deer carcass, a Jesus sign, and a cross. And I was talking to David Wharton, who's a professor at the Center for Southern Studies at Ole Miss, and is also quite a good photographer. And we were looking at images, and I said, "Well, David, you can tell that picture wasn't taken in Rhode Island." And he says, "Well, what about it tells you it was not taken in Rhode Island?" I said, "And thanking Jesus. It's got a Jesus sign, a cross, and a deer carcass. Is that not enough?" So I looked, and I said, "Well, those are sweet gum trees in the background, and sweet gums are the native tree in the Southeastern forest, so obviously that's not good." But you know, that's one of the interesting things that we're going through. I think this collection would be boring if you looked at every picture and you could tell it was from the South. And we're not trying to as much document the South as to define it through the photographs. We're trying to gather a collection of interesting photographs and let the viewer decide, is there still a unique South, and what is it that makes it the South? Maybe there are deer carcass and Jesus signs and crosses everywhere now. I don't know. Just like there are McDonald's and, you know, Walmart. But that's what our goal is, not to, you know, say here's what the story is. Our goal is to get these pictures and start conversations about what, you know, what it is the South. Is it unique? You know, obviously there are a lot of universal themes and thoughts and truths in every form of art or literature. So I'm sure there's a lot of that there. Anyway, enough jabber from me. Sorry we didn't have the big screen. You know, if y'all got time, I'll answer a couple questions, or y'all can go on with business.
Thank you. Answer questions.
Any questions?